Your event is starting. Well, there, finally. Jeez Louise. That took forever. Don't know why, but it did. Why is my cam grainy? I guess it's because it's so dim in here. It's dim. I have it brightened. I'm gonna make myself look less blue. There we go. Cause I'm not blue over you. Why isn't it starting? Wow, that YouTube lag is real. Wow! Okay, it's a 36 second delay. Wow, that's terrible, guys! It's 36 seconds delayed! Ah! Oh, dang! I guess I should put my mic closer to my mouth. That might help all of us involved. What's up, stream? I like doing that off key. Hi, stream. I look not right. Look at my eyes. They look really glassy. Oh, this light is just weird. I'm like really white right here and then dim here. It's just weird. Because I'm wearing white. Let's do this. Let's make it even more white. Wait, do I want to do that? Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. I'm gonna make it big. Oh, it's so big. Wait, no. No, not you. You. Wow, I'm so bright. Let's maybe make it not so bright. A little better. Ooh. I've been listening to a lot of Taylor Swift. It's so funny because I don't know what, I heard one of her songs on the radio, Taylor Swift song, and I was like, this is catchy. And for the longest time, I was like, oh, Taylor Swift, I will not succumb to the hype. And it would just go one song at a time. Every time a new song came out, I hated it. I wanted to freaking stab my ears out. I thought it was dumb. But after hearing it enough times, I was like, oh my gosh, it's like taking over my body. I'm bobbing my head. And singing along. I know the words. Oh my gosh. Okay, this song is pretty damn kitschy. So then I love it. Ugh. And I'm like, okay, another Swift song bites the dust for me. That I resisted, I end up loving it. And so anyways, lately I just thought, man, you know, this girl is super talented, and without fail, every single one that she's released, every song, I have come to like. So I was like, you know, I want to check out some more stuff. And actually Rick had heard her new album and was like, it's every single track is a hit. It's just such a good album. And I was just like, wow. So I wanted to check it out, and I checked it out, and sure enough, like, every song, I don't know if it's something about this album specifically I really like, because I never was annoyed with any track I first heard. There's, like, a fuzz somewhere right here, and so I keep, like, go away. Yeah, it was just, like, felt like a song that I'd already been singing to. It was... And then if you've been following me a while on my vlogs, I've listened to a track over and over and over and over again. Basically, the last album I just got done with on repeat for months was the Ed Sheeran album. And before that was Bruno Mars. And then I actually went back to Bruno Mars because I was all like, I don't know where to go. Where do I go from here? What do I want to listen to now? And that's when I was like, oh, Taylor Swift. And now I've been hooked on that and just been on just looping the album on repeat. And then Rick gets a call to be in her performance for the AMAs. It's like really freaking crazy how the world works, you know? It's like, it's a secret. Just think about it. It will happen. Big boobs. Big boobs. Just kidding. yeah. So, and then now Rick has that song stuck in his head because he's had rehearsals for hours on hours on end listening to the same track. Which, to let you guys know, be sure to tune in to the American Music Awards tomorrow evening. Check your local listings. I don't know what network it's on. I'm terrible. I need to Google it. I need to find out what network the AMAs are airing on. But the Taylor Swift performance opens the show, so you want to be sure to be on time. And Rick, be sure to look out for Rick. He'll close her performance. So there's that. Yay! Rick Belambre on the AMAs. Never thought that would happen. That's so funny. The music awards. That's funny. But it should be awesome. Like, what? This is going to be epic, you guys. Like, just mind blown. I don't know why I just did that. Go back. Okay. So, what's up, guys? Hey! Welcome to the stream. It is where I'm going to discuss a little bit more. Everyone keeps asking, Lisa, how did you and Rick meet? How did you and Rick meet? Blah, 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 blah. What's the story? And I was like, I'll tell you guys about it another day. I'll tell you guys about it another time. And I haven't done a live vlog in a minute, and I thought, you know, I should do one. And then what would I talk about? Because you guys haven't been writing in the comments what you want to discuss. It doesn't have to be all the time about something about me. It could be a topic that you guys want to just go back and forth about. You want to hear my opinion on it. Maybe you want to bring your personal experience to the table and discuss it. You know, that's cool. Write it in any comment section of any video of mine, obviously. We'll cover them, you know? Let's do it. Every live vlog will have a subject heading, subject matter to discuss. Not that we're married to it only, but just as the main focus. So this main focus is Rick and Lisa, the untold story. The story that you've all been eager to find out. And it's funny. It's a funny one because it's not your typical, oh, we met through friends, or oh, we met out and about, da, 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 and then, you know, we hit it off. It's super complicated, but super funny. And I like sharing it. There's lots of ups and downs, and it's like we should script it. We need to write it out because it could be a B-rated film. anyways. Steffi, what's up, Mogwai, whoop whoop, I'm not here, you're quiet, or maybe it's just me, yep, that was when my mic wasn't here yet, Ice Cream Sunshine Dude, what's up, there was to be even Rick, oh man, Google Translate, fail, Ruby, Red Ruby, what's up, sorry, Caps, aw, thanks for apologizing, it's on ABC, okay, good to know, ABC, now, when I see ABC, I'm all like, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L. Well, we all know how that song goes. Wait, what are we talking about? Something about Taylor Swift? Oh, we were. Lisa, did you ever get the Dragon Age keep working? I'm not sure what that question means, because Dragon Age for me never was broken. I just started playing something else, I think. And then just got busy. Train and Spray grabs popcorn. Get your popcorn. B-rated, more like R-rated. No. R-rated means it's a good flick. No. B-rated meaning like B-level. That's what I meant. B-level film. Not B-rated. Did I say B-rated? I'm sorry. I meant B-level. B-film. B-view. What's the term when it's not like awesome? Whatever. What's up, hey? Hello, Ghostly. Caps fail. You know what? I didn't get a chance to ask Rick about him wanting to give his two cents or like his side. I definitely want to go into the story with you guys, and then I'd love to bring Rick in to have him share his words and thoughts on it all too, like his perspective a little bit. It'd be funny. Let me text him really super fast. I don't know why every time I type Alex, it wants to capitalize her whole name. Be real. Be movie. Be movie. Yeah. The Dragon Age keep is how you... Oh, keep. Oh, did you ever get the Dragon Age keep working? Okay, I thought it was just bad grammar. I haven't looked further into it, but I was told that the keep was something that you did before you started your game, and I have put too many hours into that game to want to start over with a new story. I'm cool with the default, you know, what ifs. I don't know it enough to, or at all. I mean, I'm getting a better idea about the storyline, but I didn't know it about anything about it before jumping in. This is my first Dragon Age, so I didn't want to mess it up. I wanted it to tell me its story, how it's meant to be, I guess. Deneen Kiefer, aw, you're so pretty. You're so sweet. I mean, I was reading it. Hope I spelled that right. Alex is A-L-Y-X, actually. But, aw, I heart your face. We heart your face. And hey. Dude, English, please. Okay. So, while Rick decides how, when he wants to come up, we'll just dive right in, shall we? And feel free to interject with comments or questions along the way, along the story. And we'll just go that route. Rick said that begins a new film. What is it? Oh, yeah. Rick is starting a new film. We don't have all of the details. I don't know. Yeah. It's a film, I believe, for Hallmark. I'm not sure. My spelling is bad. My grammar isn't that bad. And also, if you're not bothered about the keep, does that mean you won't be playing it a second time if you complete it? Yeah. What do you mean if I complete it 100 hours later, I'm going to decide to play it again? No, I definitely won't be playing it again. Unless it's down the road and Dragon Age is, all of a sudden, for some weird reason, there's an apocalypse and the video games stop pumping out every year. Every freaking month, there's like a new damn game. Well, hurry up, Red Rover. But, yeah. So, look at this. Damn baby hairs. Look, that's so annoying. This is what happens when you have a baby. What? Baby gives you baby hairs. It's so weird. Look at that. Oh, man. I mean, I'm thankful it's growing back, but shit. It's so funny. All right, let's dive right in, guys. Boom. Okay, so take it back to September. Let's see, I'm trying to think if I want to start with my story before leading up to meeting Rick. Maybe I'll introduce the whole thing of meeting Rick and then we'll go back, okay? Red Ruby. Okay, I'm back. Kiefer says, oh, I'm sorry I spelled it wrong. I have a conclusion. I can't remember how to spell something. And just letting you know, my name is Brenna Kiefer, not Denon. That's my mom's name. I didn't want my name to be on your tube as my username. Oh, oops. Well, I kind of said it, right? So, okay, so I don't know what that means. I hope you're old enough to be here. I don't want to get you in trouble or you to get me in trouble, but, at least it's growing back and not going bald. Yes, Mogwai, that would definitely be a plus. Okay, so we'll start. Okay, September 2007. Is that right? Yes, I believe so. September 2007. And I don't know if you guys have remembered how long you've been following me on my vlogs, but this summer I had done a fashion tour called Glamorama, and they do that every year. So 2007, I did it. I've done this show like forever, and all of a sudden, 2007, there's new people, a bunch of new people. Because usually it's kind of like I'm not comparing it to Victoria's Secret at all. No, you guys don't understand this. I guess this would only be on a modeling side. But basically, with, for example, the Victoria's Secret show, and I use this example because you guys all get to see it. They will choose, when they cast the models, they have the set girls that they use basically every time. And then there's like five slots that they fill with new girls. Very few. So all the rest of the world is vying for those spots. So it's kind of like Glamorama. They have their set girls and guys that they like to use, and then they'll kind of cycle in some new ones there every now and again. Well, every year. Anywho, so Rick was one of them. And I remember, you guys know how I am. I'm loud, outgoing. Like I said, I do this every year, so these are all my peeps, and it's hype time, it's super fun, and everything just shut down on my face here. It's really dark. But so I was really excited to see everybody, and I'm the one that's up there on stage being loud. You're just like, where's Lisa? Oh, there's Lisa. You can't not hear Lisa. She's talking very loudly. We hear Lisa. That's me. That's my role in this whole thing in general. So I had a boyfriend who was on the outs with. Wasn't a negative thing. It wasn't like a bad thing. It wasn't good either, though. It was just like, I was kind of lost. So I was actually engaged to this guy. So there's that. So I was engaged and brought my problems to Glamorama, and I had been discussing them. Well, Rick is there and he is hot, but my first thought, like, I kid you not, was he's hot, must be a dick. He's being quiet. He's a douchebag. Like, I hadn't even spoken with the guy yet and I already judged him. So I'm just sitting back, I'm like, whatever. And just, doing my thing. I don't know, just like here and there, you know how you do when you're around somebody you're kind of attracted to, especially severely attracted to, you find yourself flirting, you're kind of coy, you're just like, blah, blah, blah. Me, I get a little bit more obnoxious. That's just how I function. I kind of grew up being made fun of when I was a kid because I was like, my brother and I were like the only ethnic kids in this whole town, small town of white families, other than one other full Korean girl, but she was adopted by a very white family. And so these kids just didn't understand, you know, this ethnicity situation. My brother and I got made fun of a lot. So I think this kind of built me up to be very, like, it really wore up my, you know, insecurities. I got super insecure about life, and I think I learned to counter that by being obnoxious and trying to make people laugh and be funny and be goofy. And so like to make a scene at my expense so that, people would accept me more. I don't know, but when you're a kid, you're just like doing some really crazy things. Cause actually in turn, I was just viewed as annoying. So, me annoying? What? Guys, me never. So anyways, so yeah, so just kind of like, that's just how I am. I had become to be built. And even now I struggle with that where I'm just like, quit being so loud and obnoxious. You know, sometimes it's legit just high on life. Sometimes it's me being uncomfortable. I just did my thing. I think countered my attraction to Rick with more obnoxiousness because I was engaged and I was within myself, I think, fighting that, you know, like, no, I'm not supposed to be attracted to this guy. I'm engaged. Rick had a girlfriend who apparently he was having issues with as well. This is at that time was a 4-city tour, and the first stop is Minneapolis, and we're there for a whole week. So we're there for 7 days, and that is how much time we spent together. So, you know, I think I just kind of here and there flirted every now and again just to be silly, but not, you know, didn't pursue anything because again, I was engaged and he had a girlfriend. So I was like, whatever. And I thought he was a dick. So we're just all having fun. And, but like I said, all the while I was trying to figure out what to do with my engagement because I wasn't 100% happy, but I was like, will I find another guy that is better than the guy that I'm with now? He doesn't cheat on me. He's not like that. And there are worse things. For me, it was like, I lost respect for the, for my fiance. He, being a model, trying to act, wasn't, you know, nothing was coming of it. His modeling kind of took a pause at that time, and he was kind of getting bummed out. I then in turn, he wasn't the romantic kind either. He wasn't the type to, okay, I should preface, I guess, that it's not all about that. Like, oh, he has to do these things, which is why I compromised. I thought, okay, he doesn't like to hold my hand. He doesn't like to open the doors for me when we first started dating. They're just like those little signs. They're signs. They're not deal breakers. They're just signs into a person's character. And I was like, okay, there are worse things. He could be a dickhead. He could cheat on me. He could, or be a cheater. He could be like, whatever, a douchebag. He could be the, but he wasn't. He could do drugs, but he doesn't. He, you know, it's just like, there are worse things. And I was like, I can deal with that. We can work with this. But fast forward 2 years, and I obviously, just a slew of things, like, I can't find my, I wasn't finding myself able to be 100% loving with him anymore, wholeheartedly. But that's all it was. It wasn't like we had a falling out. It wasn't like he did one thing or I did one thing and broke us up. It was just like, it didn't feel like, I mean, I'm about to marry this guy. You know, I wanted to make sure I wasn't 100%. And it's funny because not funny, but I think to myself all the time still that if Rick hadn't come into the picture, I would have married Brian, and I probably would have divorced Brian. I never went to the idea of marriage with thinking that divorce was an option. We all say that, and you hope for it, but you know it's back there, you know it's an option, so you know it's an escape route, so people use that as a safety net. Me, I didn't want that safety net. It's forever. Marriage is forever. That's what I wanted. I did, so if I had one inkling of doubt, I had to address it. So this is where that I'm going backwards. When I moved to LA, the earlier that year, as soon as my fiance and I had moved there, he proposed to me. So it was like, we're engaged now. And this should have been my sign. We get engaged, never set a date, never started working on the wedding, nothing. I was just like, I don't know, we'll figure it out. And come that springtime, I found myself, I literally snapped. I was like, I don't know what's going on. Like, a guy hit on me that I thought was cute, had feelings that, and things stir in me that I hadn't felt in the longest time, and that not to be confused with the newness of something, which is what leads people to cheat, which could be it, which it really could be it. Maybe it was just something within me that I think I had put it off, was like, I'm engaged, I'm in a serious relationship, I'm not a cheater, this isn't like my thing. But I met someone else, and because of how I felt about it, was a sign to me. And because it's like, you shouldn't have these feelings for someone else. If you're with someone that you love and you want to spend the rest of your life with, you will not have these feelings, like the same feelings that you do with your lover as you do with another person that you just met. That is your sign. Now, not to say that this person you just met is going to be your forever, but this is like the red flag that says, don't get married because you're obviously not ready, or this isn't ready, or this isn't right. Something's not right. And so that I brought that to my fiance and was like, okay. And at this time too, I was really deep in my faith with the Lord. And, so for me, I was like, I don't know what's going on. I have to figure things out in my heart. And I was just trusting the Lord. I didn't understand my heart at that moment. I didn't understand what was going on. I just knew that I wasn't 150% for my fiance. So I was like, I have to move out. I was fasting. I was praying. I was really trying to focus on God and try to figure out what his plan for me was. And it's weird. It's really hard to explain. I know it sounds weird and crazy, but it's like that kind of faith, that kind of trust is when you're there, you just can't explain it. Like I was in the safety of living with my fiance. We had a great 2-bedroom apartment. I went from that to a small 1-bedroom by myself in Los Angeles. I knew nobody. I just was like, I don't know what it is, but something's telling me that I need to get right with myself. I need to move away, move out. We need to not live together. And me being a Christian is another story. Me being a Christian and then living with my fiance at the time is also, I have words for that too. That's a different story. Because the whole thing about living together before marriage is all in the word specifically about lust, the temptation of sin, and is way more prevalent when you're living together. So I justified it as, well, if we're not committing these sins, why can't we live together? So I think, anyways, that's another topic. So, where was I going with this? Okay. So I moved out. My fiance's heartbroken. I'm like, I don't know what this means. I don't know if this means we're breaking up. I don't know. Just trust that in the end, it will be good. If we break up, if we stay together, it'll be good. If we break up, it'll be good, because that'll be the plan. Like, that means then it wasn't gonna be good if we stayed together, and then that way he could go his way, I go my way, and we can find the good, and just have faith in that. And I moved out. He moved back to Chicago, and we did this long distance thing for a while, and I was just like, I needed to be with myself in my mind. So living by myself all summer, my fiance's in another state. Now come September, that's when I meet Rick. And this whole time, like I said, I've been tooling around trying to figure out what to do. Do I marry this guy? Is Brian my forever? And I meet Rick, and I was like, didn't think anything of it because I judged him and thought he was an ass, right? I'm just like, this isn't gonna be an option. He's cute, but he's not an option forever option, you know? So I don't know what happened. So we get there on a Sunday. Thursday, a group of us decide to get some people together to play poker. So we're playing poker. Rick's in there too, and we're flirting. But like I said, he has a girlfriend. So it wasn't like I was trying to get in his pants or anything, or vice versa. We were just two people attracted to each other, just playing poker and whatever. Well, and not, you know, it's just like, it's there, you know, it's there, but you don't cross that line because you know it's inappropriate. So all the while I'm like talking to my girlfriends there, what to do with Brian. Like, I'm not happy, but will I find a guy better than this? Will I find a guy that's gonna not cheat on me in the future or whatever? Like, what is this? So Friday morning, Rick comes to me and says something about, guess who's single now? And I was like, what? And apparently his girlfriend, they had a fight that night before, because there was a girl playing poker with us there that was one of the models that apparently knew Rick's girlfriend from childhood and was like, oh yeah, da 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 da. He told his girlfriend that night that so-and-so was there, says she knows her, says hi, blah blah blah. Then, well, Rick's girlfriend got crazy jealous, livid, screaming with him. Like, apparently she got mad at him because one time when Rick was lying on the ground in the theater reading his sides, I walked over him. Me and some girlfriends were like walking over because he was like laying down the aisle. So we had to cross over the aisle to go where we needed to go. And I don't know if we were laughing at him or we were just had some words in passing and we giggled and she heard our giggles and they got in a fight over that. And so she was like, basically a very insecure actress that couldn't stand that Rick was around other cute chicks. And she was just really insecure about it. So yeah, they had been fighting. And then when he told her that about this girl being a Glamorama, she flipped on him. And I guess, I don't know what their thing was before, but it might've been like another thing, you know, stacked up. And she was like, I can't do this anymore. Da 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 da. Go have fun being single. And this is me paraphrasing because I don't know exactly. And it was a while ago. So, but it was along those words. And so I guess, you know, poor Rick, he's crying because he's such a sensitive person. And he cried all night about it. But the next day, tells me he's single. And I was like, oh, wow, okay. Me, my heart's like half in single town, half in married town, and doesn't know which side wants to live on. So when Rick happened that Friday, it was really cute because I don't know how it started. I believe he started it. We had basically like what we tease about our first date was on over, what's the word I'm looking for? Over, text message. Cause he was like, hi, my name's Rick. Do you come here often or something? And we just like went back and forth like we're, you know, our virtual selves dating, you know, kind of thing. And I was like, yeah. And then he's like, oh, let's have a picnic. And I was like, okay. And oh, and we're having a picnic in the grassy hill or whatever. And then it's like, oh, we're looking at the stars and all of this. And it was PG. There was nothing naughty happened in that little date. It was cute, you know? And I was like, this guy is so sweet and romantic. Like who thinks of that? I definitely in my 2 years, some being with my fiance at that time, hadn't felt that. And I was like, I was like, this is the hole that's in my heart that hasn't been able to be filled by my current love. I'm like, and when I thought that I could sacrifice and compromise on that, my current love wasn't romantic, and wasn't like in that way, you know, handsy and sensitive with me and emotional. He was very frat boy. He was very, I mean, that's what he was. He almost like it defined him, you know, like he was just like, super sweet guy, mama's boy, super sweet Midwest boy. But at the end of the day, he was still very like little frat boyish, a little bit sexy, but not all cracked up to be. So, yeah, it was just like I was rolling with it. And I'm not condoning jumping into a relationship with someone when you're already in an existing one. So don't take that. I'm not trying to say that that's right. And that the way that Rick and I did things is right. I'm just sharing with you what happened with us, how we came to be. So Friday is the big show that we've all been rehearsing for all week. Friday, we have a show in the afternoon and that's our dress rehearsal, but they kind of opened it up a little bit more to like to some people so that some people can watch our dress rehearsal. So it's a full run through with dress and hair and makeup at 1 o'clock. And then the big show is at 8 o'clock at night. Well, after the first show, after the finale, like there was this rafter up top of the stage and Rick and I are up there like with a bunch of other people, like half the models are up here, half the models are down here with some musical artist. I don't remember who it was at that time. Oh, it was a country theme. I remember because I don't think Rick was wearing a shirt. He was just in a cowboy hat. and jeans and cowboy boots or something. They like to make the guys be shirtless as often as they can in this show. Because the ladies love it. But at the end of it, we're like, whoa, yay, bye. And he runs by me. He stops and whispers in my ear, I think I'm falling. I was like, you don't tell me this, mister. I was like, he did not just say that. And what girl doesn't like to hear that? I'm like, what the heck? So I was like, oh, hell no. Now he's really tugging at my heartstrings. So the show happened that night. Then there's a big after party after that everyone goes to. People that watch the show can go to. All the talent goes to. And we're all there. And long story short, Rick and I are hanging out. And then we make out. Yeah. We're like on the dance floor just making out. And I still have a fiance. His just freshly broken up girlfriend's still back, or ex-girlfriend, is still living in their apartment where they live together. And we're making out on the dance floor in front of everybody and just having fun. I think that's the one where I fell. Yeah, I think that I fell down and scraped. Like, I fell down metal stairs. I slipped in my heels. And fell down on my shins. I basically sledded down metal stairs on my shins. Skidded the whole front of both of my shins. Like, I thought I was not going to be able to model for a while. It was that bad. Like, they were bleeding. Like, the whole front was just covered in blood. And luckily, our hotel is just across the street. So, I don't know if I went or someone went for me. Yeah, I think someone just went for me and grabbed my Chucks. And I just was wearing my strapless mini dress with Chucks on, and bloody shins. And he took care of me and it was super sweet. So yeah. And then from there we were just kind of like, okay, now what? he didn't know what's going on. He still has to, close things out with his ex-girlfriend. And I'm having to be like, yep, I have to break off my engagement. This, like, you don't make out with somebody else and then go back to your fiance and act like things are fine. This is not okay. Like, this was when this whole time of all these months of me tooling around, do I marry Brian? Do I marry him? Do I marry him? Making out with Rick was the final red flag. It was like, yep, I'm not marrying Brian, clearly, because you don't make out with someone else if you want to marry a person. Which is why it really bothers me when guys have like these bachelor parties and they're off like whoring it up. Cause it's your last free night. You wouldn't want to do that if you wanted to marry this person. So if you do that, I guarantee you, I would put freaking money that that relationship ends in divorce or massive unhappiness. So anyways, that's another topic, but so that's Friday. Saturday, I think Saturday, I called my fiance. The next day, I called my fiance and I was like, I broke up with him. I don't think I made it as hurtful as saying, I made out with someone else, we're breaking up. I was just like, it's not working out. Hang on. Alex is up. I have to let Rick know. Oh, okay. Rick was actually, going over his script and stuff like that for his new film. So, and now Alex is up, so he's got to go get her because I'm talking to you guys. Here, let me just take a break real quick and look and check what you guys are writing. Didn't you write down a list of things you could make your vlogs about? Oh yeah, I am not here. Yes, I did write something. I just don't know where it is. I think I did. Yes. I have to go like back through it. Sometimes too, it's gotta be relevant or if I want to talk about it or do at that time. And then it's like, is there enough to talk about regarding this topic? Is there enough people that want to talk about this topic? What's up, Anthony Marino? Sorry for the delayed hello. Sounds like it wasn't there anymore. You are right. Rick wanted to play strip poker. Probably. Girlfriend toxic syndrome. Yeah, everything above the shirt, it was PG. No. And then there was blood. It's all fun and games. Yeah, okay, so what else? Where was I? Okay, so I break up with my fiance. And I am like 100% all about this new relationship with Rick. I'm thinking, yay, all is answered, all is good in life. Now my confusion with my ex. Now I'm dating this guy, man of my dreams. He's so hot, he's so sweet. We're dating, he's awesome. He likes to hold my hand. He likes to, be next to me. He likes to sit close. And girls love that, by the way, guys. Girls love that shit. They eat it up. And if they don't, that means they're just not that into you. So, so I'm thinking back to LA. Because mind you, this whole time my ex was back in Chicago. So we weren't even together. And so I go back to LA. I'm thinking, oh, it's good. Yay. Rick goes back to LA. He's having to pack up his stuff at the house that he lives in with his ex-girlfriend now. And he goes and crashes on a buddy's couch for a while he's trying to figure out what to do next. And in the meantime, he's basically over at my place all the time, and we're hanging out, and we're like, woo! And that is when he brought his Xbox over to my house, and that was Halo 3, and I would watch him play. I remember just sitting there and just watching and being like, cool. I'm like, I'm done watching. I'm bored with watching. Give me this controller. And when I played, the first time I played, holy cow, I was so terrible. I could not keep, like, I wasn't coordinated with both sticks. I was like, what do I do? I was basically, my character was aiming at the sky more times than it needed to be, and the ground, dying a lot. I don't know at what point, but I just kept on with it, and it clicked, and I was able to pick it up, and I actually became really good at Halo 3, crazy enough. It wasn't like I was mediocre. I was pretty good. Maybe not pro status, but pretty good. Like, better Halo then than I was now, or am now. Granted, because Halo was a totally different game style and game style that I'm used to, like, the running gun of Call of Duty. So it's just a matter of, like, riding a bike, right? Get back on it, and maybe if I were to play Halo for a while, just Halo, I could probably get good at it again. But it was funny. So we'd hang out. Like, it was literally just everything I could ever want. Cuddling on the couch, watching movies, it was the best. He'd rub his hands through my hair, and he'd touch my cheek. All these little things that I'd never got in my past relationship coming to fruition in this new guy, and it was amazing. So, Mogwai, I'll punch you in the dick. and all was good in life. And so he was basically at my place all the time. And so, like I said earlier, I wasn't having sex before marriage. So there was none of that happening. And that was kind of also a test too for me. It was like, will he stick around if he's not going to get sex out of me? And a month went by, month-ish. And he tells me, I think I had a job. I was gone out of town shooting. And he tells me, oh, I was at Target and I ran into my ex, and she was with her mom, blah, blah, blah. She wants to have coffee to kind of, like, just have some closure and just talk about things and all this stuff. And I was like, I thought that was super random. I didn't think anything of it. I was just like, yeah, go have coffee, go meet up and, close it up. By all means, close that shit up. So he goes to do that, I think. Yeah, he goes to do that. And apparently it was just her pleading for him to come back. I will be better. I will change. Please let, give me another chance. Blah, blah, blah. Please, I want to try again. And Rick will say, if he were here right now, he would tell you that, well, we'll get to that in a second. So then he tells me this stuff, and I was like, okay, well, what do you think about it? And I never got a confident response. I was like, okay, well, Rick had a job down in San Diego, And he for like the whole day or maybe a day, and then he came back the next day. I think it was a whole day. He left in the morning and then he came back that evening. He gets home, or home, my house, gets back, and it's a long drive, okay, from LA. It's like 2.5 hours or more, or it could be up to 4, depending on traffic. So he gets back, and something's not right. I can tell something's not right. And I know him now. Like, Rick is a super thinker. If he's got time on his hands, and he's just got a lot to think about, and it's quiet, and he's alone, he really thinks about those things. So that's what he did. He was really trying to weigh his options with what he had just gotten from his ex-girlfriend, what's going on with he and I, and the odds of both decisions. So I want to say it was that night when he got back. He tells me, I remember being on my couch, and he tells me that he hasn't gotten a chance to like regroup himself since his breakup, that he just jumped into us and he needs some time. Now that hurt my feelings already in itself. And I was just like, this sucks. I was ready. I was like, let's do this. And he does this to me. And I was like, what? So that was already something I had to digest. And I was like, that sucks that he doesn't want to stick around, that he needs his time, but okay, there's still hope. He just needs time, but there's still hope. So, and then I don't know, part of me was just like, is he going back to her? You know, like, what's going on?
Morning, hi, Bubba.
I don't know if you're in the, nope, they can't see you. There's the fam bam. What's up?
Say hello.
What's up, one shot? Honey, you want to explain to everyone what you were thinking when you basically said, when you broke up with me, basically?
What I was thinking?
Like, in all honesty, like, what did you had this long drive just back from San Diego, you concluded. Can you guys hear Rick okay?
I was going back to my ex.
Yeah, I know, but what were you thinking?
That I wasn't an idiot, but I really was at the time. I don't know. I was thinking that I didn't have closure with my ex, and I went back to her like an idiot.
I'm not asking for your assessment post-fact. I want what you were thinking at that time.
I don't remember.
Wow, Rick's memory spans about as long as a bird's.
No, I just don't. I don't think back to that part. I have no reason to.
Anyways, so Mogwai says they could hear you. Okay, good.
Thanks for that.
They know I was joking. But, yeah, he told me it was because he needed to get right with himself and he needed time. So I was like, all right, he just needs time, so it's cool. Part of me was like, is he leaving because he didn't get sex? You know?
Ah.
Yeah. And I kept saying that to him. I was like, is it because? And he swears it wasn't.
No.
Is there, how many, can you step to the left? How many green things are left? Just one or two?
2.5. Maybe I should give
her
that.
Yeah. And the bottle is in there too. So Train says, love you, Rick. Heart you, Rick.
Love.
One shot says, tell Rick I said hello.
What up, One Shot?
Rick says, whoop.
Oh, sorry, I did that right in your ear.
So, anyways, so that was that. And I'm thinking, okay, this sucks. It was a really awkward feeling time at that moment for me. My heart was broken into a million pieces. I thought things were going great. And out of the blue, he's like, I need to figure out some stuff. I was like, okay, that sucks. Well, I want to say not even a week later, a few days later, like 4 maybe, something like that. I still had some things over at his place, his friend's place, where he was crashing at, and I needed to go pick them up. So I went over there to go get them, and he, you know, I'm hanging out with him, and in that moment, I remember just being like, ugh, I love this feeling. I just want to be next to him. This sucks. It's awkward. This is weird. Why? I don't like that it's awkward between us. Just the other day we were making out and it's like now it's awkward. And then I think when I was leaving and he was walking me out, I noticed on his, and he to this day is terrible at this, he still had the placard on his dash of his car to the building facility or the apartment complex. He still had it up, and that's where his ex-girlfriend lived. And I was like, So this asshole went back to her. I was so pissed. That helped me to get over him in that. It wasn't that I was over him, I guess. I had to hate him to get over him because all that had happened. I couldn't believe it. I was just so heartbroken. I was in a million pieces and my rage was the only way I could get over it. So I deleted his contact info in my phone. I completely kiboshed any trace of him in my life so that I wouldn't be like drunk and accidentally call him up in some either anger stupor or sad stupor. So Magway, it was a parking pass. So that was that. And I've just like totally hated on him to all my friends, told him how terrible he was. I never want to see him again. Alex is over there laughing at the dogs. Yeah, they're funny. Yeah. Oh my gosh, you guys are so cute. Anyways, so that was that. I think that was in October. So mind you, we had just started we met at the end of. Oh, we met in August, right, babe?
Yeah.
Oh, August of 07. That's when we met. Because the first week of August. Wait, right? Yeah. What? I'm starting.
End of July, early August.
But I thought it was. Was it not after that first trip that we?
It was Weimar.
I know, but the first. Minneapolis.
The long one.
Yeah, but that would have been in August. But then I thought we broke up in. If we broke up at the beginning of October. How we were only like dating for like just over a month.
Yeah. It wasn't long.
Yeah, but then that doesn't make sense that we started hooking up at the beginning of August, broke up in October.
Why?
Because that's 2 months, Richard.
Yeah, because I was still with my ex before that. Remember? It wasn't until the second trip that I actually was like, okay, this needs to stop.
Okay, so that was it. Yeah.
So that was in September.
Okay. Anyways, so yeah. So it was like the end of September, beginning of October when he tells me this stuff. And So I move on. And we both were the same agency. We didn't see each other ever until March. And we both got booked on this print job. I was the girl and he was the guy. And we were shooting together. What are the fucking odds? Excuse my French. But I was so pissed. It was the first time I'm seeing him since. And he, in his mind, what were you thinking?
Oh shit.
I don't know if you can hear him, but he said, oh shit. And I was like, I don't want to be here. And we have to change in the same changing room. He's over there in his underwear. I have to be over here in my underwear. And I was like, is this happening right now? Ugh. So I was like, kind of like this, acting like I'm okay, but I was really broken inside, acting like all tough and hard on the outside and being like, whatever. And at lunch, I was just like, hey, what's up? Whatever. And then you're a jerk.
Yeah, right. No, you went. So how's Haley?
That was the first thing I said?
Yeah.
Yeah? So I guess I asked him, first thing out of my mouth was like, so, very condescending, like, so, how's Haley? And, I continued on to tell you that that was messed up.
I rocked your world,
Yeah, that I told him that he fucked me up. Oh, I didn't even tell you guys this part. This is why it was such a big deal, I guess, for me, too, is, I mean, I forgot about it, but I just remembered, because I was like, I remember being really, really, really depressed. And it's because, at the same time, my great-grandmother was dying. Oh, my gosh. So, it sucked, because Rick broke up with me, and then my great-grandmother was dying, and... So I had to, so I flew back to my family in the Midwest in Kansas City and hung out with everyone. Basically, my great grandma was at her house in, I don't know what they call it, but like, you know, when they have a nurse there and they have all of the stuff. Thanks, Debbie. They have the, basically they were, She was going any day. They just didn't know when. And so my great grandma was being monitored at home, and we were all at her house, just hanging out with her. And then eventually she died. And so my heart was just like in 1,000,000,000,000,000 pieces. I'm not one to take medicines because ever since I had learned that medicines are really just to mask your pain versus heal the pain, I stopped taking them unless I really needed it, like ibuprofen for my cramps or for an intense headache that I couldn't get rid of. And, man, it really hurts holding in tears. But I was so depressed, you guys. Like a feeling I had not ever felt. I was so bummed. I didn't want to go back to LA. I didn't want to be back in my apartment by myself. Trying to act happy. Going on castings and seeing all my friends. Because I wasn't happy. Like... And my grandma gave me some of her Ativan. I didn't even know what that was, but she told me that this would help me to not feel so sad. I was wearing, because like I said, I don't like to put chemicals in my body if I don't need to, and unless it's beer. No, but serious. So I took it like, she said it's like a small dose, but I took like half of it at a time because I didn't know what it was, what it would do to me. And I did find that it actually cut that anxious feeling inside my gut. It's really weird. I just remember being like, holy cow. It's like as if, you know, everything's cool. Like it feels like everything's cool again, but I'm still there. Like my mind it's not like I was cloudy or anything. It was, it was like I was normal, but the feeling in my gut was gone. And I was like, wow, cool. I was like, can I have some of these to take back to LA with me so that I can, like, get through my days? Because I'll be by myself. Because at least there at home, I had my family to be with and to kind of, like, escape the reality. So, I don't know. She gave me a handful to, like, just... I like babied that stuff. I was like, okay, I took it whenever I really couldn't deal. And it was just, so I'd take like a half. Those helped me get through those really, you know, sad moments when I needed it. I knew I needed to cry when I needed to cry, but if I needed to be okay and go about my day with work is when I would save those four. And then, yeah, I mean, I don't remember how long it took. Thank goodness it wasn't like it was stuck in it. You know, you just got to be strong. You have to think positively and you have to know that it's not the end of the world and just keep pushing yourself and just start focusing your desires in a different place, right? So I had to remove where that a large chunk of my desire was on Rick. I had to focus that on to something else. I had to just shift it. And the time that it took for me to shift it was all I needed. And then it finally... I was able to bring it somewhere else. And whether that meant spending more time at the gym or doing more things with my friends, which I think is what I did do, was just really try to keep myself occupied, was out of the house a lot. anyways, so then by the time I see him again in March, I mean, I was just super bitter. And he apologizes to me. I don't remember. What did you say to me, babe? Do you remember? Something. He apologized. He's like, if it means anything, I'm sorry. And I respected that. I was thankful for that. But I was just like, sorry doesn't take it back. Sorry doesn't. It's like, great, cool. Sorry. Fine. I'm still here doing this and you're still there doing that. Fine. Sorry. Cool. But I didn't want to stay mad at him, but I still liked him, you know? But so that was that. But like I said, I had to continue to make Rick a bad guy in my mind in order to go about my day. So fast forward, gosh, I don't know, maybe another couple months. And then we both do a fashion show together, and which a fashion show has a lot of downtime. So a lot of hurry up and wait. Mail. We got some mail. And so we're hanging out, and I remember just trying to be cool around him, acting like it was no big deal. Though inside, I was just like, he's so hot, he's so cute. Oh, I want to be with Rick. Why won't he be my boyfriend? But the outside was composure. It was just like, I try to be as confident as possible, because it's like, you can't force it. You know, if it's not, then I was never one to chase. But I'm being honest with you about what my feelings were. You know, it's like, I wasn't going to allow my feelings for him to dictate my actions to be... Hey, Callie. It's a full-on conversation at the front door. So I was just cool and whatever. And in my head, I was just like, it was over. It wasn't like I was thinking there could be a chance. I was done with him. I was done. But it's still really difficult to be around somebody that you're attracted to, but you've deemed them to be the devil. So I had never, when I saw him, I was never like, I want to try to get him back. I was just like, ugh, he being around him because he makes me feel awkward. That job's over. And all the while, my ex was still hanging around because he swore that I was his soulmate. He would do anything for me. Part of why I broke up with him too was his resistance to Christianity, I guess. And I had told him that he would have to be a Christian if we were going to get married. So that was something that bothered me, because he didn't care to go to church with me. He didn't care to pursue that side of my relationship with the Lord. And I was like, this guy doesn't care about me. And at the same time, I'm just like, you know, okay, well, I didn't want to push it. Because that's the thing. It's like when you're trying to, when it comes to someone else's salvation, it's like, I can't make it happen. That's all. That's God's work. I can only be the example. And I tried to do my best to lead by example. I was at church a lot. I volunteered a lot. I was there all the time. He had gone with me for a little bit, but then had stopped, and I stopped pushing him because I wanted him to have that want and desire to go to church with me. I didn't want him to go because I made him go. Didn't make him go. He slowly slipped away from that. And that kind of, I guess, put a damper on things for me too. So in the time that I was in LA, pissed with Rick, broken up with my ex was doing everything he could to put his life in order of way that he thought that I would be happy. So he like got proactive about work. He started, you know, producing things. He started just being active on that front. And he pursued Christ with his own desires and got baptized that summer. And all the while he's, you know, because he knew, I had told him that he wasn't that sweet romantic guy that I guess I needed, that I didn't think I needed, but I do need. And so flowers were coming to my house like every other day, cards, teddy bears, like he was not trying to be cheesy. He was legitimately trying. But it's just one of those things where it was like, well, I don't even know what the saying is. A dollar short, a day late. I don't know what that is. But it's like, we're already broken up. I've already gone past things. To me, I'm also analyzing the fact that it's like, we broke up. Like, I broke up with you because I didn't feel whole. It's not going to be right to get married after all of this, because that's just not what, I don't know. That's just what was going in my head. And what's that thing hanging in the background? That's Alex's jumper. It's connected to the ceiling. thanks, Daniel. Anyways, so in this time, like I said, in that summer, my ex and I were talking, and I kept him around. I never committed to him. I told him I didn't want to be his girlfriend because in reality, I was trying to find something else. I was like, I knew my ex wasn't the one because I broke up with him. I wasn't happy, you know? And so I wanted to see, while I'm single, I wanted to exercise that, what it was to like date and find what other prospects there could be here in LA and try to find somebody that I might be happy with. So while my ex is sending me flowers and cards, I'm dating other guys in LA. So I wasn't anyone's girlfriend until this one guy that I met, who was terrible, who was everything indicative of a douchebag, and he wasted 3 months of my life. I wouldn't say complete waste because I did grow from it. I learned he was a complete tool bag, like porn all over the place, all over his computer, cheating on me, talking to girls, flying in girls when I was out of town, Facebooking other girls that he slept with. I mean, this guy was the epitome of douche, like disgusting. Anyways, so, but while I, you know, and I was honest with my ex, I was like, yeah, I'm talking to this guy, you know, blah, blah, blah. Like, you and I, we're not together, so I can do these things. And I was just bold with him, and he stuck with it. He was like, he thought he was just gonna let me exhaust it out, and he would be there to sweep me off my feet when I was done with that. And it was starting to work, because I started being like, I just dated douchebag after douchebag after douchebag in LA. It's like, it's terrible to be single in LA. I so feel for all the single people in LA. It is a very terrible thing. Cause the people suck here. I'm sorry. I'm just going to blanket that. For the majority, they just suck. It's very difficult to find someone that's real, honest, doesn't have a motive. So that's kind of like, that's what people will say here, is when you do meet somebody as like, even just a friend, you're like, oh my gosh, it's so hard to find real people. Let's be friends. We're friends now. So, and cool people, nice, genuine. So, yeah, so I was talking to my ex and I thought, I'm not going to find anybody better. This is what life is. I literally thought, you guys, this is what they mean. Like, you have to settle. This is life. This is, you have to settle. When you get married, you settle. I had that in my mind. This is life. That's, you can't have it all. You cannot have your cake and eat it too. That's, you just can't. You can't ever. You will never be 100% happy. You get married to somebody that you have to settle with. Settle on. All right. Well, there are worse things. So I'm settling with Brian. So, yeah. We started talking again more seriously. I started like not really talking to other guys anymore. I didn't commit to my ex again. I just was like, I'm just going to play it by ear, just take it as it goes. But I think I got to a point late summer, early fall, late summer, where I was just like, yeah, we can maybe try being serious. Let's try. Like, I was inching my way there. I wasn't his girlfriend yet, but I was like, all right, I'm not going to date anyone else. Let's just see how this goes. So, and we had, I got, you know, booked. Glamorama comes back around again, and the second stop is in Chicago, and he's still in Chicago. So I was like, and I was visiting him, you know, in the summer times when I would have jobs in Chicago, we would meet up and hang out. But so we already planned, like, oh, the Chicago show, you'll come to the Chicago show, we'll go to the after party, we'll hang out, like, da-da-da-da-da, we'll do all these things. Like, it was on this path. Well, here comes the next Glamorama, Minneapolis, and boom, Rick Malambre is there. I was, like, talking to Brian, I remember being on the phone with him, being like, you will never guess who is here. Because I just talked, I badmouthed Rick to Brian. Brian, of course, hates Rick because Rick stole me from him. So Ryan's like, I want to just choke this guy out. And and I was just like, oh my God, I can't believe it. Ugh. And at the same time, I don't know if I believe Rick, but no, I'm kidding. I have to. When Rick broke up with me, shortly after that, my motorcycle, I think I had gone away for a job for a few days. My motorcycle was stolen when I got back. My custom Gixxer, black and white Gixxer, was freaking stolen. I blamed it on him because he still had my key to my gate. And it was just really peculiar timing. Like, if it wasn't him specifically, he told someone to, here, go grab this bike, give me a cut, take it, da-da-da. To this day, he says that he has nothing to do with it. So, anyways, so that was that. So it was just like, what? Rick's like, I'm not even going to comment on that because he knows what's up. Just kidding. I was just so angry with Rick, you know, there's all these things. So I was like, oh, you couldn't believe who's here. So I'm there and I'm just like, whatever. But I'm like seeing Rick and like, man, he's so hot. Damn it. So Sunday we get there for fittings. But honey, was it Monday? Yeah, Monday. Monday after rehearsals, right? Yeah. That trip, I brought all my Rock Band gear. So I brought two luggage bags. One was all my clothes for the week and the other was my Rock Band equipment. I brought everything except for a set of drums. I brought two guitars, multiple mics, the keyboard. What else do you bring for the Rock Band? The games, the Xbox, everything I needed. And then I bought the drums at Target, used them while I was there for that week, and then returned them when I left, before I left. But anyway, so the hotel, we're at the hotel, and they have like an area where you can play games and be loud or whatever. So plugged in all that stuff, set up the Rock Band things, and a bunch of us models were just playing Rock Band, including Rick. And I remember towards the end of the night, we're flirting. And mind you, Rick is back with his girlfriend now. At that time, they were back together. And I officially was not back. I was talking to my ex, but we weren't officially back together. So she says. Rick's like, so she says. Yes. If you ask Brian, he will tell you that I never said I was his girlfriend. But you were making out with him. Just because I make out with him doesn't mean that I told him I'd be his girlfriend. I made out with someone else too. Like, come on. You can make out with people without being their girlfriend. Yeah, the right, I haven't even gotten to that point yet. Anyways, so I don't even know where I was at, you freaking loud mother trucker. If you're going to freaking interject where it makes sense. What was I talking about? Oh, yes. Okay, so Monday night. So we get there on a Sunday. Monday night, we're at the bar, and I'm the hotel bar lobby area. And I was like, I went up to him. I was like, honey, do you remember what I said? What? Do you remember what I said? It was, how did I bring it up? Were we just like, we were doing that weird flirty thing. I was just like, oh yeah, blah, blah, blah. And I think I just was like putting the hardcore flirt on. I call it Angelina Jolie'd him. I said to him, I was like, this is the ideal situation. And he was like, what do you mean by that? And I was like, well, I don't have a boyfriend. You have a girlfriend, but I don't respect her and you don't respect her. You don't care. And something I was like, so I don't know, did I say we were going to make out? I was like, so we're going to make out. Something like that. I was like, yeah, I'm going to torture him. No, I was like, I was basically coming at you saying that I knew that you didn't respect your girlfriend enough to be faithful to her. And I was like, I'm going to get you to do what I want. And I am not with anybody, so I can do what I want and it's going to happen. And Rick was like, nope, it's not going to happen. I have a girlfriend. And I was like, it's going to happen. Don't you worry. And, because I loathed his girlfriend, right? Because she took him from me, right? This is a vicious circle. Like, I didn't take him from her, though. That's the thing. Rick left her for me. Then she took him. She stole him back.
I didn't leave her. She left me.
Oh, that's right. She broke up with you. That's right. She broke up with you, which then you left her. If it weren't for me, you would have probably resolved things.
Correct.
Yeah. Which you resolve things after the fact, but I freaking got burned along the way. So I was pissed. So that's why I had this. I was just so bitter with Rick. And I was like, I'm going to fuck with this guy. Excuse my French. I was so pissed with him. I was like, I'm single. You have a girlfriend and I don't care about your girlfriend. I know you don't. And I just wanted to toy with him. I go, I don't want a relationship. I don't want you as my boyfriend. I just want to make out. I'm like, we're here on this trip. We're going to make out and have fun. I go, why not? And he was like kind of giggling and like, you knew in his head, he was like, I want to, but I can't. I'm going to be the good guy because I have a girlfriend. I was like, doesn't matter. So I every day I would put the full court press on. And by Wednesday, guys, it just took 2 days after I said that to him, we're making out in the hallways of the hotel. And Rick laughs about it because I broke him down. I was like, I was all up in his face, you guys. I was like, you're going to kiss me. Yep. It was like straight up movie type. Like, I didn't give a damn. And I'm like, we're making out. And I was like, nope, you want to make out with me. I know you do. It was just so like everything you would see in the movies. It was just so funny. And I don't know how it happened. Do you remember?
What?
Like how we went from talking to lip locking. Like what? No, Callie, get. Honey, will you get Callie?
Callie, come on, Callie.
And we were making out. But I was like, no, baby. You've got to get her because she's like hanging out over here on the thing.
Callie, get. Come on.
What is he doing? Callie has been acting weird. She just wants to be inside my butt. So where was I at? Yeah, but because I didn't want to be with Rick, I needed to keep it on the down low because I was probably going to go back with my ex.
She was with
Brian. Oh my gosh. So I didn't want it to, and it, so it kind of added to the excitement of it all. Plus, he had a girlfriend, so, you know, we couldn't be obvious about this. And I totally toyed with him. I played hardcore and was like, meh, meh. And I don't know what happened Thursday. Do you, babe? I think it was just, like, random. We're at the theater, and just every now and again, we'd probably, like, make out in a corner or something, and then, like, run back out to everyone. Like, we're cool. Everything's cool. Friday was the party. We weren't hiding it on Friday, were we?
No.
I don't think so. Yeah. By Friday, at the after party, again, full on making out. Just, yeah. No, we weren't, I don't think.
No, we weren't.
We couldn't have because I was still talking to my ex. Yep. Then Chicago was the following weekend, which remember, my ex was coming too. And I was like, oh, dang. Okay, so here we go. So Chicago show. My ex goes to the show, I believe. I don't remember. Anyways, then he's coming to the after party. We're all hanging out. Next thing I know, Rick goes up to Brian and is like, oh, man, you know, I'm sorry. He's trying to apologize for last year's debacle. I had no idea.
I had a plan.
Now it's I had a plan? Well, do tell us, Richard Malambri.
I was just being
we can't hear you over the water.
I was being a jackass. I was
you were being a dick? You were trying to be nice. Don't even act like you were trying to be cool. You wanted to be nice.
He was in my territory. I was just trying to make it all right for the time being.
Oh, please. So I remember being in Chicago and like, yeah, so Brian is the one that I was going to probably seriously pursue. Rick was just for fun. And, so I remember we all went to a club after the after party and Rick, I teased Rick because he was dancing all over these girls. And he was like, Will, his response always would be, Will, you were making out with Brian over in the corner. And I was like, oh my gosh, jealous much? Alex, no, no, no.
She just walked from the dog crate today.
She walked over there? Oh my gosh. You guys, she's taking more steps every day. So crazy. Your life is a full-blown soap opera. No, think of why. This is what I was telling you. Like, this is why. I'm like, this is a whole story. But you can make, like, a B-level movie or whatever over it. It's just so many aspects to it. So, yeah. And I just remember thinking, like... And Rick, I think, started making out with some of the other models. So that's why it's a whole nother... See, he
that was the year before.
No, it wasn't. You retaliated. You want me to really get into it? That was the year that, because Machiko was the one that told me the next day. I remember being with Brian and Machiko texted me telling me about your shenanigans on the drive to the airport.
Well, you weren't there, huh?
No. Because I didn't need to go to the airport. I was staying there with Brian.
You're right.
Yeah. So Rick, Mr. I Have a Girlfriend, was making out with two other models. Yeah, and he's all like, you were making out with Brian. like a total mess. So I don't know, this is where it gets a little blurry for me. Wait, at that point did we have LA and San Fran? We didn't. Oh, it was just Minneapolis and Chicago. So Chicago was over, and then I think after that, what happened with you and... Oh, Rick's girlfriend was in another country filming another movie.
She was in Greece.
Yeah, she was... She was in another country filming a movie, and Rick was hearing reports that she was having sex with the director. So it was just getting really weird, just all over the place. And so, I don't know, Rick and I kept in touch because it seemed like, even though it was like... I was still like, whatever. Obviously, I'm super attracted to the guy, but I was like, this guy is not serious, you know? Like, he can't be real. So, he and I kept in contact, however, after, and started hanging out, and I was having fun with it, you know? I was like, okay, cool, whatever. Like, honey, will you heat up my coffee, please? And it sounds terrible, but it's like, this is life. This is what happened. And I justify it because it's like, I told my ex that I was not his girlfriend because I wanted to make sure. I was like, I don't want to be anyone's girlfriend. I wanted to be free. I was a girlfriend pretty much all my life that I'm just like, I need to not, or my adult life, I need to not be a girlfriend and just have fun, do me for once. Which is what I did for that whole year. So Brian was my serious. Rick was for fun. Rick was there. Brian wasn't. He was in Chicago. So Rick and I just were hanging out. And Rick, I don't know at what point Rick decided that he wanted more. But I said to him, I remember being like, boy, if you want more, you're gonna have to prove it. I had like the Great Wall of China up between us. I was like, you have completely kiboshed any trust I had with you. I don't believe anything you say. I don't believe you at all. So I'm like, you have to be on your best behavior and you're gonna have to try real hard. I'm not gonna try shit. You're gonna have to try hard. So Rick tried hard. I don't know if it was just the timing of things. Like Rick's, I guess, hearing the sour news about his girlfriend not being faithful led him to being like, well, I'm not gonna be faithful. It's just like the circle of just messed up nonsense. But that's love. This is what happens. It's like, and these are the things you do to find the one that you're gonna be forever married to. So I don't know. Then it's just like we started hanging out, and it took like a couple weeks to realize, all right, well, I guess I will be serious about this. I'll take this seriously. So then I had to break up, like I had to cut it off with my ex. Which what was sucking for me was the fact that I was building it up for him. It was this long year of doing things to better himself for me, which I'm glad he did those things because it made him a better person regardless. They were amazing things. And it made him a better man for his now wife. Like, he couldn't have married her had he not gone the path that he had gone for whatever reason, for me or whoever. Those details are another story. But, so, yeah, it just sucked for me because he built up this whole year of trying to show me that he's worthy, that he's a good, he's changed, and, he's done better, and that we're, like, even the idea of talking about wedding rings was coming, engagement rings was coming back on the table, to then I have to tell him, no, it's not gonna happen. That sucks. It sucks. And here's the topper, guys. I didn't want to do it over the phone. I wanted to do it face to face, but he's in Chicago. I'm in LA. I get a job that has me in Milwaukee. I asked him to drive up to see me. It's like an hour and a half drive. He knew something was wrong. But I didn't know what else to do, you guys. I didn't want to do it over the phone. And I had no way to get to him. So he drove up and I broke it off. I don't know what the word is. Not broke it off. Yeah, I just ended it. I ended up, I was like, it's just never going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's not. It's done. We can't do it. And it was terrible because to top it all off, it was his birthday, guys. I ended it with Brian on his birthday. He saw me as his soulmate, and I ended it on his birthday. Like, oh my gosh, you guys. Ugh, what are the odds? Like, it's just, this job had to be on this day. What's up, Blitz Gamer? Yeah, I'm okay. I'm just explaining the story of Rick and I, how we met. So that sucked because it hurt my heart so bad because he's such a good guy, you guys. Like, there's not a bad bone in his body. He just wasn't those other things that Lisa needs in a guy that Rick gave me. That's what Rick had. Rick possesses those things, and that filled me. That was the one little hole that I had in my heart that was missing. And no matter how much Rick or Brian tried, he just couldn't fill that for me. So it was so sad. Like, we were just crying. I mean, you guys, just, again, to go through with the whole movie thing, both of us in my hotel room, just on the bed, just crying our faces off. Oh my gosh, so terrible. And then on top of it, I tortured him by saying, like, I asked him to stay because I felt bad. I didn't want him to just drive up, get the news, and drive back. I was like, no, stay. So it's kind of like, it sucks to just drive back immediately, but at the same time, it's like, do you stay and continue to torture yourself? I don't know. I didn't know what to do. I asked him to stay the night, and Rick's laughing. Oh, you're laughing at Alex? Yeah. And it was like, we just like, held each other all night. I felt bad. It was kind of like the sweet ending, you know, the sweet goodbye. Like, this is goodbye for good. It was so bad. And then I went back to LA and started getting serious with Rick, though still making him jump through hoops to win my trust back. I mean, he had a lot of damn hoops to jump through. Yeah. Do you remember, can you recall any obstacles you had to jump? Like anything that stands out for you, babe, when we first started dating, for real? No. Honey, can you heat up my coffee pretty please? Yeah. So, yeah. She's all up my butt. I don't understand. Good. Not good. And then, yeah, somehow I became a public enemy number one in Chicago because I broke Brian's heart. Brian was like the poster sweet child, sweet boy of the city. Everyone loved him, thought he was so adorable. And then I broke his heart, so I was the bad guy. I went to, I believe maybe the story was something along the lines of, I haven't heard the official rumors, but I want to say it was along the lines of, I think they think that I went to LA, got starstruck, and I became a different person, and I just was this evil bitch, and I broke up with Brian, I broke his heart. I think that's how they think it went down. Here. Thanks, baby. Might be hot. And, but it's like, whatever, you can't keep people from thinking what they want to think, and I'm just like, it just, upsets me when people are like, judge you, and they don't even know the details. Oh, stretch. Whatever. So Brian and I owned a condo together, so I was like that ex-wife. Like, we had to still continue to talk over that property because we were renting it out. And, I didn't settle on a number. I was like, if you want to buy me out of this, you want to get rid of me, you have to pay me this much money. And I don't even feel bad about it. And that just kind of was the icing on the cake of the hatred, hate Lisa Train cake. So there was that. But the awesome thing about that was going on with Rick. I'm sorry, with Brian. Because this would be the fall of 08 is when I broke up with Brian. Or broke it off with Brian and started dating Rick seriously. And then that following February was when all that property issue was going down. But, and then my brother also died at the same time. Like, so many things, like, happen at once. It's like, it doesn't just one thing happen every now and again. It's like, let's just have all these things happen right now. So I was dealing with that all at the same time. So I guess I just didn't have any room. There was no room in my heart for Brian to be even, to feel anything. And then Rick was there for me when my brother died. He never got to meet my brother, and that's what sucks. My brother was like gonna be moving to San Diego from Virginia that April, and he got in a car accident in February. So that sucks. So Rick was there when I went home. That was, I think, probably when he met, like, my whole entire family. Was at my brother's funeral. And, yeah, the rest is history. That's kind of how we met, and that's how our relationship started. And then, now that's 2009. Fast forward, October 1st, Rick proposes. Fast forward, that's 09. So fast forward to May 2010, and we're married. Now fast forward to November 2014, and we're married with a baby! What? To what you guys see today. Yeah! Anyways, so for those of you that have come into this a little later than the very beginning, I had explained how I have come to be this obnoxious and forward through my childhood, growing up, my childhood being teased. Growing up, being teased all my childhood. Yeah. Yep. For being Asian in an all-white town. Anyways, but I'm utilizing my weakness for good. I'm turning it into a strength. And yeah, that's what's allowed me to be vocal and entertaining for you guys here on YouTube. Just doing my best to give you guys all the raw, real, and honest of me and life and whatever I experience. I want to share it with you guys. And yeah. Can you repeat that all? No! Oh, thanks. I'm just gonna call you Kiefer. I'm not crying. But Aunt May, Auntie Mae, yeah, totally. No, that's exactly the story. It's like I call it that. I say that I pulled an Angelina Jolie on his ass. I straight up went in there and wrecked that shit. Because it was meant to be. It was. But it's just funny. It's just an example of how messed up things are. And it's like, just pursue what I did. It seems like it's not very conventional, if you will, but it's, I followed my heart. I didn't, not in the sense of like that saying I follow like whatever my penis wanted. Yeah, I want that. I want that. I meant like what my heart wanted for real, you know, not, oh, I want this donut. Oh, I want this. Nothing, not instant gratification. I want, what did my heart, what could I do right now to fulfill my heart? What was my heart desire at that moment? On a deeper level, you know, and I just try to listen to that and follow it. And that has led me to be in this most real, amazing, and awesome relationship. You know, Rick and I weren't different when we met, even to who we are now. We've both grown together. We've learned a lot about being, you know, in a relationship, in a committed relationship, being married, being parents now. It's just so crazy. And just when you have to look and seek that base foundation of trust and love and respect. My dad says that that's like the trifecta: love, trust, and respect. And all is like all equal. And he's right. I mean, it all has to equal. You can't have love and respect without trust. You can't have love and trust without respect. You know, you can't have trust and respect and not love. I mean, if you don't love, then that means you're just not married. This is talking about marriage, right? Or in a committed relationship. So it's just about, I feel like maybe if anything from my story, you can learn that never settle. I guess that's kind of easier said than done. Just I don't know if part of my story is that I was lucky that with my job I was able to travel and have the opportunity to meet wider people. Well, no, you know what? Because in this day and age now, you've got the internet. This internet dating thing it's real. It's legit. That's how you do it anymore. You can't find the douchebags that live in LA. You can't date in those pools because they're just terrible. The easiest way to sift through them is on the internet, I guess. So it's like what you do, like good. Now, before it used to be like a weird place to go. Now it's legit. Like if you're single, that's what you do. Like nobody wants to go to bars anymore and meet people because the odds have been slim in finding the one in a bar. So you know, this whole get online. Don't settle. So I will stick with that. Don't settle. Do not settle. Don't marry somebody that you feel that there's that one piece that you're like, yeah, but if there's ever a yeah, but don't marry that person. I'm telling you, you will not be happy. You will either live your life, the rest of your life in misery, or you're going to end up in a divorce, which could lead to more misery as well, or happiness, but you still got divorced, which meant you shouldn't have settled, which meant you shouldn't have gotten married. Don't marry someone unless you are 100% whole about it. But people are 100%, but they've got blinders on. They're like, what I don't know won't hurt me, but I'm 100%. And a lot of people just want to be married to be married. A lot of people want to be married knowing that their spouse is off cheating, but they support them. So they're like, whatever, they pay the bills for me. I'm cool. I can just stay at home and just get my nails done. Whatever. Whatever suits your fancy. if you're gonna get married, just get married for real. That's all. It's like a real life Lifetime movie. I know, right? I'm telling you, we should totally make a film about this. We need to script it out for sure. We need to do Ooh, I found my zodiac symbol. Not to get off topic. Is Rick doing housework half naked every Sunday at 8 a.m.? Just asking. Don't blame me. Is he doing what? I don't get it. I don't even know why you would ask me that. Come to Australia. I want to go to Australia. I've never been. Well, that was interesting. My girlfriend and I are getting food. Game with you later, Lisa. Later, one shot if you're still here. I fail. Mogwai. You guys are funny. Oh, okay. I'm just rereading some of these comments. No, I do not understand Portuguese. Brian got the hit marker while Rick stole the kill for the final kill cam. GG. That's awesome. So true. I want to show you guys. Let's see. So you guys are going to think I'm crazy when you see this. You'll be like, what? So don't, this is why you can't base everything on looks. I wonder if I can paste an image into the chat. You think I can? Nope. Oops, what am I doing? Okay, here. I'm just gonna show it to you for a split second. Where is it? Where is it? Where do I? There, that's it. That was Brian, and now he's gone. Forever and ever. And now he's married with 3 kids. Man, they were just pumping him out. They already have 3 kids. I think they had 2. Like, they got, he basically met this girl who he met while he was courting me. She was chasing him. And he was like, this girl, da da da. And I was like, oh, cool. And then when I broke up with him, he probably found solace in her. And then they started hanging out. She's Christian. And they got married really fast. And then all of a sudden she was pregnant. So I assume that she got pregnant and then she's like, shit, I'm Christian. We need to get married. And then we tell everyone I'm having a baby. I'm just assuming. I don't know. I'm totally gossiping right now. I have no idea. But it's just funny. Have I ever been to France? No. I would sponsor that. I don't know what that means. Melambri Productions. Hold up a mirror to the monitor. Why? What does that mean? Okay, guys. Well, Rick was supposed to be at lunch at 1, and this should have been a quicker conversation than it was. I apologize for it being this long, but there's the story in a nutshell, for the most part. I wanted to get Rick in here so he could interject with his thoughts and stuff, but he's busy looking over all his production stuff for his new film, which you guys will be kept in the loop on what's going on. Don't worry, we'll let you know as we know details and as we're able to give you details. So let's see, what is this? OMG Lisa, let's gossip. All right guys, you guys are fabulous, thanks for watching. I should edit. I told you guys I was gonna put up a Life Not Yet Rated video up. It will start back up in November. And Monday, this Monday is the last Monday of November. So if I don't get one up Monday, I'm a liar. And that's terrible, guys. I don't want to be a liar, but I don't want to start something that I can't continue on properly. Why won't my chat stay? Oh, it is. Okay. Whoa. What is happening here? All right, guys. Well, there's that. Whew. That was weird. Now I feel weird just reliving all of that. Ugh. Having to think about Brian. It's crazy. And just crazy that it's been so long. Time flies when you're having fun, you know? It's like it feels like Rick and I just met, you know, not too long ago. And we've been through so much already. It's awesome. And we're excited for the future. I told him, I was like, hurry up and book more movies so I can have another baby. Because I just want to have one more. At least. I at least want to have one more. He's like, well, I'm kind of having fun with one. I was like, no. Well, it's funny how it's turned. In the beginning, I was like, no, we're only having one. That was the most painful experience of my life. Because I did childbirth 100% naturally. And now it's like, okay, I want one more. I'm talking about it like it's a donut or something. What's up, Straight Edge? And then as I was folding away some of Alex's smaller clothes that she can't wear anymore, I thought they're so cute. I was like, man, as much as I don't want to have another, like, two girls, I want to have another girl just so that she can wear all these clothes that didn't get worn very much. And then we don't have to buy any clothes next time. We have all the clothes that we need. Talk about saving some cash money. That was great. LOL, came in at the wrong time. Straight Edge. Well, it's later is better than never. You missed the whole thing, but this video should be up shortly after I stop streaming and you can watch it again. Get the whole gist. Alex 2.0 soon. Yeah. Well, and what would really suck is actually we have an awesome boy's name picked out because we thought Alex was going to be a boy. And so we had an awesome boy's name. And then when we were told it was a girl, we were like, what? Now we have to come up with a girl's name. And I want to use the boy's name. Contemplated using it as a girl's name. Could be. Nowadays, people are naming their kids whatever they want. I'm just going to name my freaking kid Headphones. It's going to be HP Melambre for short. Whatever. Anyways, the traditional form of the name is a boy's name. So, I don't know. You know what? Actually, did you know Courtney was originally a boy's name? A boy's name. And now it is a very popular, but a popular girl's name. So they totally just flipped the script on that one. And now we're cool with it being a girl's name. And now it's like we hear a guy being named Courtney and we're like, what? The world is so weird. Try Tristan, not my name, just saying. Okay, guys. It is over. True love always wins out. Yes, yes, yes. All right, guys, you guys are fantastic. I heart all of your faces. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in tomorrow's vlog. I guess what I was getting at about editing Life Not Yet Rated was that I wanted to stream some games later, but I may or may not be. So hopefully you're following me on Twitter at twitter.com/LisaMelambre. Or you're just following my channel already at twitch.tv/IAmLucyMay. And it'll tell you if you have notifications set when I go live. All right, guys. See you laters. I'll see you on the flip side. I'll see you on another screen somewhere on the internets. Peace.